contact. Good morning. Welcome to Living Goat Bible Church. Good to have you with us this morning. Lord's provided a beautiful day outside again. How many are enjoying the cooler temperatures instead of the hot weather that we had? Me, yeah. So anyway, it gets cools down at night now for a change like that. So, well, the first thing we're going to do is sing some praises to the Lord. Get Wilson out of the doorway and get him in here. He didn't even hear me. So anyway, okay, would you stand? We're going to sing. Praise band's ready. Take it away, Rich.
My life, and the scripture that goes with it is, "For no one can lay any foundation other than the one already laid, which is Jesus Christ." This song is all about the foundation that we build our lives upon. There's no greater foundation than Jesus Christ. And as a church, we believe that if we put our faith, hope, and trust in Jesus, we will build our lives upon the foundation of Christ. And if we give ourselves fully to God, He will do things in us and through us, both as individuals and as a church, that we could never dream or imagine.
Worthy of every song we could ever sing, worthy of all the praise we could ever bring, worthy of every breath we could ever breathe, we live for you. Jesus, the name above every other name, Jesus, the only one who could ever save, worthy of every breath we could ever breathe, we live for you. Holy, there is no one like you, there is none beside you, open up my eyes in wonder. the name above every other name. Jesus, the only one who could ever save. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you. We live for you.
Lord, we come before you this morning, and that's our prayer, to fill our hearts with your love. Let other people see you through us. Just fill this place this morning with your Holy Spirit, Lord, as we gather together in your house to worship you. You've proved yourself over and over to us. You're the same today, tomorrow, and forever. And Lord, we just thank you so much for all the gifts that you give us. We just especially thank you for the gift of Jesus, who died on that cross, suffered a horrible death to cover our sins, Lord, that we might spend eternity with you. Lord, we just thank you so much for your love, your grace, your mercy, and especially your forgiveness, Lord. Lord, just bless each and every one that's gathered here this morning, and just bless each facet of this service to your holy name. And we just pray this all in the precious name of Jesus. Amen. You may be seated.
I want to invite Michelle up. At first service, I forgot about Michelle, and but we got it caught back up.
Her name sometimes.
Yeah.
You forget names.
I heard that. We were watching online. I saw that though.
We survived camp. It was a great experience. It was great to be back and being able to stay overnight. We had 67 campers, which was a big group. That's the second largest that I've was in charge of, so it was great to have most of the kids back. I would like to have all the individuals and campers to come on up. If you notice, our shirts say happy campers, so we need to be happy, okay? That was our theme this year, was happy campers. So any camper or anyone that helped volunteer and at camp, please come forward. We could not have this camp without all these adults and teenagers that help. We had, I think, 26 adults that helped, 5 teenagers, and it's such a blessing for me to have all these individuals. It can be something small or something, just something simple. I have one that just comes and starts my campfires for me. That's we have people, Jack and Marie came, and Jeff Box, they helped get the food, so it's really nice. Walmart has the pickup now, so I pull up with 3 vehicles, and we just sit. And it took us Our appointment was at 10. We got there at 10, and we had everything unloaded at the camp by 10:45. So that's how quick it does. So thank you to Walmart and Hy-Vee and Fairway for all the pickups, because it used to be I had to go around the store every time and make about 4 or 5 trips and take it out to the camp and come back. So again, I want to thank, if you were a first-time helper, you guys want to raise your hands if you were a first-time helper. We have some new people that came to help, and so I appreciate them and joining in the fun, and some regulars that came. But we had good weather, and we have some stories to tell. We have a snake story, and we did have one get bit by a wasp, but we had to deal with that, unfortunately. But we are outside most of the time. We had a night of no sleep, a few of us, because of homesick kids. We get that. Because last year we didn't stay overnight, and I had forgotten how worn out you get when you stay there the entire time. Last year I could go home at 7 p.m., get rest in my own bed, and go back and start up, you know, at 6 a.m. But does anyone have anything to share that you want to share? No one wants to share anything. The snake was in the porta pot. And so the snake was, the story was, we had some wasp issues, but we've had them even at my own home. So one was a little girl got bit, but the girl was going to use, and we knew there was a wasp that was in that porta pot because it's down by the lake. And I said, if you see a wasp, just don't go in there. And so Sarah and I had sent her, and we're standing on the beach watching her, and all of a sudden she just tears out. She's sprinting towards us, and we said, apparently there's a wasp. And then all of a sudden she yells, snake! And she goes, she comes over, and she was pretty, I mean, for me, I would have been more scared. She just said, it was just a garter snake, but she was scared. Well, then some boys find out there's snakes in the... So the next day, you know, they let it rest for a while, but word got around camp there was a snake in that porta pot, and that child was going to go in and catch it. And so I was not down at the lake at that time. I just missed the excitement, but he went into there and caught the snake and came out of it again. Here's the snake, you know, so, and we just put it back in the wildlife. But they need to understand we are, we did have, when I started setting up, we had 2 stray dogs there. I called Sean. I said, do you know whose dogs? They were nice dogs. That one got into Sarah's car. I had to drag it out because it was ready to go traveling with her. So, but they were, unfortunately, we couldn't find, one had a collar. Sean took care of those for us, but very friendly. We could have had dogs around, but I just can't have that with children. But anyway, we had a great time. I want to thank Winnie for doing the Bible lessons for middle school, and I did the elementary. That takes a lot. Out of doing camp now, Rich came up with a new guitar. He has to have an outdoor guitar, so, you know, that's a good excuse, you know. But he ended up with a new guitar so he could play it outside with the humidity. It doesn't damage it. And Victor here, he was my multitasker. He was a floater. He had to make concrete this year for us for a while, and then he was down at the lake and everything. But I appreciate everyone taking their time out. Some came and was just a dorm dad, so they worked all day, was a dorm dad, headed to work the next day. So if you ever want to be part of this, I love being out at camp. Anything can happen, and it's a laid back, and the kids, you're going to see a video, and you'll just see the joy the kids have of it. So thank you.
Power like the power of Jesus.
Camp is one of those things that we've been doing in this church for a long time. Winnie, any idea how long it's been going on, or Rich? Over 30 years. And it's been at Camp Strother when it was still a camp. And when I was here, when I moved here, we had it down at the fairgrounds. And now it's out at Forest Lake. And I didn't realize how much camps cost until my boys got to the age where I started looking at sending them to camp. And you realize the cost that people charge. But we put on this camp completely free to the campers. And it turns out to be a great outreach and a great ministry. And so it's a great thing that we need to continue to support. And you saw how much fun they were having. Michelle was telling me that at one point she was having a conversation with someone. And you know, when you're in leadership, you tend to see all the things that you need to fix. and all the things that need to be done. And you forget that the kids are still having fun. You're doing leadership right when they're unaware of all of the things that are going wrong, because you're the one fixing them, and that's what a leader is to do. And so the kids were just having a lot of fun, and so that's a testament to the leadership Michelle provides, as well as all the other people that were in this video. So thank you all. Let's do one more recognition. And to the kids, I kind of wanted to hear what Jake had to say about camp. Did you have fun? Good. It's all, that video was fun to watch. It was the first year in 12 years. By the way, Michelle and I celebrated. We both had our anniversary for the church. Michelle, 5 years, and I've been here 12, so I'm going on lucky number 13. And so it was the first time I'd ever missed camp, and I apologize for that. We'll be looking forward to next year nonetheless. Well, I want to draw your attention to the prayer concerns that are printed in the bulletins. Let's see. I want to just mention Gary McDaniel passed away. Gary attended this church. He attended first service, and he passed away, and so we need to pray for his family. Also, I want to mention my mother-in-law, Leanne's mom, Dorothy Hollingsworth, from Packwood, and she is in Iowa City, and complications with pneumonia, and it looks like she's doing better, but we'll be going to see her this afternoon to make sure she's doing okay. I also, Marge, you're out of the hospital. That's good. But we'll keep praying for you for sure. And then I also want to mention Josh Ezery. Josh, I put out a phone call last night. Sounds like he had a stroke and he's unresponsive right now. And so we need to keep praying for him. I also want to mention to pray for college and high school students. I shouldn't say just high school, all students, pray for them and their safety. And then also for the situation in Afghanistan, we need to make sure and pray for as well. Any other prayer concerns? Marge? So Haiti and then storms headed to the East Coast. Absolutely. Any others? Oh. Okay. Any other prayer concerns? Okay. I think the state fair has taken some of our people, maybe, and last minute vacations. But nonetheless, we're here to worship God, and we're three or more gathered, so he's with us. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, Lord, we just praise you, and Lord, we just ask that you, Lord, I just pray that you put on our hearts, just break our hearts with what breaks yours. And Lord, I just pray that you move in a mighty way. And Lord, I just pray that you continue to speak to us in everything we do and everything we say. And Lord, I just pray today for the names on this list. Especially we pray for those that have lost loved ones. And we remember the McDaniel family, and we ask that you provide the comfort that they need. Lord, we pray for Dorothy as she's in the hospital, and Lord, just keep her safe, and Lord, provide a healing touch for her. Lord, for Josh, we pray for a miracle, and we just pray that he may come out of this. He's far too young. And so, Lord, we just pray for a healing touch upon him. We pray for all of the people going off to college and going back to school, no matter their age. Lord, we just pray for them. We pray for their safety. We pray that you may protect their minds and their hearts. And Lord, let them feel your love no matter where they're at. Lord, we pray for the situation in Haiti. And Lord, our heart goes out to these people. And we just pray that you move in a mighty way. I just pray that the story surface of how you were with them. And Lord, we pray for the Afghan people, and we pray that you keep our troops safe and the people over there safe. And Lord, I just pray that you squash these radical Muslims, and I just pray that, Lord, that they may just fall at your feet. And so, Lord, we pray for all these things. We pray for our nation. We pray for continued guidance. And, Lord, we just ask that you move in a mighty way. In Jesus' name, amen. At this time, I want to invite, if you brought tithes and offerings, you can take them to the back. I'm also going to have the children meet in the back right now. Preschool through third will be going with Michelle, and fourth through sixth with LaVon. And I'll say a blessing over them. Oh, yes. So we have a pretty large collection of puppets, which frightens some people. But we had a thriving puppet ministry at one time, and they had been stuffed away for quite a while, and we brought them back. And so Brenda, Garrett, and Sherry Bedford brought them back, and so that was kind of fun. Kids like to see them. So let me pray for the kiddos. Heavenly Father, Lord, we just pray for Children's Church. I pray that everything goes great. I pray that you may keep the kids safe. And Lord, I just pray that they may be strengthened, renewed, that they come to know you better and more clearly. In Jesus' name, amen. And so, as you're taking your gifts and tithes, we are going to have Larry and Brenda Young have a special.
Well, good morning, everyone. When I was, did I not get it on, Josh? Am I good now? Okay. When I was trying to decide about a song when they had asked me to sing, and Sheila had it written down for me to sing, it's hard to determine what to sing. And I thought back about the days we were in college. Brenda and I went to Bible College, Baptist Bible College, Springfield, Missouri. And I had a unique professor down there. He had all these sayings. And I thought of this one saying that he had, and it was, remember, in your dealings with people and in ministry, everybody's having a hard time. In some way or another, we all have our struggles. Some of us, well, maybe mothers with children, you got to take care of the kids, you got to do the dishes, you got to do the wash, see that they're clean, all that. Guys, taking care of your family, supporting your family, supplying what needs they have. Do you ever think to yourself, does anybody care? Those of you that have lost loved ones, I know when we lost our daughter, Becky, there was times that we thought, does anybody really care? Are there other times in your life from the stresses and from the problems that goes on? Do you ever think to yourself, does anybody care? Well, I'm here to tell you, Jesus cares. He tells us in the scriptures, in 1 Peter 5 and verse 7, he says, cast your cares upon him, for he careth for you. And we go back and forth all the time, Brenda and I, about the scriptures in Proverbs. because we love Proverbs and all the things that are down to earth things for us in there. And Proverbs 3, 5, and 6 tells us, trust in the Lord with all thine heart, and lean not unto thine own understanding. In all thy ways acknowledge him, and he shall direct thy paths. When we have those cares and those times in our lives that we think, does anybody care? He cares. I wanted to share with you that last Sunday night when we got home, we got a text. And I have family that's on the mission field. My aunt and uncle started as missionaries back in the early 50s to the Philippines. And they established several churches and established a Bible school there. And it was a growing ministry. And they needed to retire off the field for health issues. And their son, Jonathan, and his wife took over that ministry. And they've been working with those churches and working with that school over there trying to train national pastors. And last Sunday night, we got the word that he had been threatened by Muslims in that area over there. And in the letter it said that his house had been burned down. And his wife and he, Jonathan, had been burned up in that fire. And I sat there and I thought to myself, does anybody care that they've spent their life over there? They've worked with those national people. They've won people to the Lord. Does anybody care? Isaiah 41:10 says, fear thou not, for I am with thee. Be not dismayed, for I am thy God. I will strengthen thee. Yea, I will help thee. Yea, I will uphold thee with the right hand of my righteousness. He cares. Jesus care when my heart is pained too deeply for mirth and song, as the burdens press and the cares distress and the way grows weary. I know he cares. His heart is touched with my grief. When the days are weary, the long nights dreary, I know my Savior. Does Jesus care when my way is dark with a nameless dread and fear? As the daylight fades into deep night shades, does he care enough to be near? Does Jesus care when I've tried and failed to resist some temptation strong? When for my deep grief I find no relief, all my tears
Patty, I wanted to make sure I wasn't going to surprise you with this. Patty Robertson's going to read scripture. You can either read down there or you can come up here, either way.
Today's reading is from 1 Timothy chapter 3, and it's the whole chapter. It's about overseers and deacons. Here is a trustworthy saying: if anyone sets his heart on being an overseer, he desires a noble task. Now the overseer must be above reproach, the husband of but one wife, temperate, self-controlled, respectable, hospitable, able to teach, not given to drunkenness, not violent, but gentle, not quarrelsome, not a lover of money. He must manage his own family well and see that his children obey him with proper respect. If anyone does not know how to manage his own family, how can he take care of God's church? He must not be a recent convert, or he may become conceited and fall under the same judgment as the devil. He must also have a good reputation with outsiders, so that he will not fall into disgrace and into the devil's trap. Deacons, likewise, are to be men worthy of respect, sincere, not indulgent in much wine, and not pursuing dishonest gain. They must keep hold of the deep truths of the faith with a clear conscience. They must first be tested, and then, if there is nothing against them, let them serve as deacons. In the same way, their wives are to be women worthy of respect, not malicious talkers, but temperate and trustworthy in everything. A deacon must be the husband of but one wife, and must manage his children and his household well. Those who have served well gain an excellent standing and great assurance in their faith in Jesus Christ. Although I hope to come to you soon, I am writing you these instructions so that If I am delayed, you will know how people ought to conduct themselves in God's household, which is the church of the living God, the pillar and foundation of the truth. Beyond a question, the mystery of godliness is great. He appeared in a body, was vindicated by the Spirit, was seen by angels, was preached among the nations, was believed on in the world, was taken up in glory. And that ends today's reading.
Thank you, Patty. Would you join me as we ask a blessing on Pastor Mark this morning? Lord Heavenly Father, we just lift up Pastor Mark before you this morning. Just ask to fill him to overflowing with your Holy Spirit, Lord, as he brings your message. Lord, just embolden him as he brings your word. And Lord, just bless us as we hear this message in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Well, Leanna and I and the boys had a great time. We went down to Alabama the last week I preached. I kept saying Florida, but it was Alabama. And Leanne and I got the wild hair on the way down. I don't know if you ever have seen the TV show Hometown, where they go, the Napiers go and redo the city of Laurel, Mississippi. We went and visited Laurel, Mississippi, and we never met the Napiers. But anyway, we had a fun time in Laurel, and we drug Grant along. I'm sure he really enjoyed that. But a lot of fun. And then we met up with some friends of ours. He's a pastor in Marion, Alabama, which is near like Montgomery and Tuscaloosa and Birmingham, kind of in that little area. And so, and his family, and we just had a great time down there. Very refreshing. We spent almost every day in the ocean, which is good, and we had a fun time. And so I did want you to know we missed you, and we watched the services online, and so we kept up. And so you met Mark Wagner. He's been here a number of times, a friend of mine, great preacher. I appreciated his messages. And very timely as well. I hope you enjoyed them. I've heard a lot of good feedback. I'm going to have to tell him not to do so good of sermons, though. It makes me look bad. No. It's good. And he sang, so that was good too. Well, today we're looking at the book of 1 Timothy, and in particular the third chapter of the book. And I want you to, first of all, imagine life in those times. They didn't travel very often, and they didn't travel very far. So the majority of their scope of the world was in their town, right there. They didn't, you think about it, you could do a day's walk, and if you wanted to go on a journey, you had to walk everywhere you went. And so they couldn't travel outside their town. You know what that means? You know people's business, right? There weren't windows that were airtight. You knew each other quite well, the good, the bad, and the ugly. So I want you to think about that. The other thing I want to talk about is this idea of standards. When I worked in manufacturing, we had the companies, one was trying to get ISO certified, and the other ones were ISO certified. Those of you outside of manufacturing, you're like, I have no idea what you're talking about. Well, imagine if you're ISO certified, that you know, other companies know exactly how you're doing business. There are certain structures and things in place that you do things the same way. And so it sets up this standard. And so one company I worked for had to do it and align itself with the FDA. So the FDA would know exactly how we made medical devices. And so this idea of standards is nothing new. Here's the advantage of standards. This particular website says, standards provide people and organization with a basis of mutual understanding. They're used as tools to facilitate communications, measurement, commerce, and manufacturing. Really what standards do is puts everybody on the same playing field, and it helps the whole communication, and ultimately it's better. And so imagine Paul planting these churches, and we have the luxury of having the New Testament. They did not have that luxury. And so imagine the false teachers of the day coming in, and they didn't have the New Testament to be able to refute them firsthand. And so the disciples had to be able to do that with their own theology and to have it set out. And so Paul would write these churches, write these letters. So the book 1 Timothy, oftentimes the book is named after the person who wrote it. In this case, it's named after the recipient, Timothy. And so Paul was writing this to Timothy, and he was telling them, warning them, and telling them the standards of which you should abide by, which means that there were people that were trying to crowd in and teach otherwise. Does that make sense? And so that's kind of the whole backdrop behind 1 Timothy 3. And so he starts out, it's a trustworthy statement. If any man aspires to the office of overseer, just anyone who wants to lead, it says it is a fine work he desires to do. An overseer then must be above reproach. They should have be a person of integrity. And I'm going to read, I did this at the first service, and I'm just going to go ahead and do it. There's a version of the Bible that is called the Message. And the Message is written in a way that makes it easier to understand. I don't very often preach from it, but every once in a while it sets things in a better understanding. And so it's one person's view of what the Bible would say in today's vernacular. So here's what he wrote. If anyone wants to provide leadership in the church, good. But there's preconditions. There are standards that must be met. A leader must be well thought of, committed to his wife. My version says the husband of one wife. To be cool and collected, versus my Bible says temperate and prudent. They are to be accessible and hospitable. I think hospitable is one of those characteristics in today's life. We've moved our front porch to the back, and we don't see everybody that passes by, right? I told the story of, in the first service, of growing up in Richland. We had what was called a two-mile walk, and it was around the outskirts of the town that you walked the two-mile walk, where the house I grew up in was on the two-mile walk, and we'd sit on our front porch and say hi to everybody that went by, right? Now we don't seem to be as hospitable as we once was. And so here he's reminding people we need to be hospitable. And so as this is written to the leaders, it's also written to the servants of the church, and it's also very applicable to everyone else. So if you're sitting there going, okay, this is written to the leaders, I don't need to pay attention. Yes, you do, because this is a very good standard to set your life by. None of these are bad things. It says he must know what he's talking about. That's good. Not to be over fond of wine. I want to remind you that back in those days, everybody had to drink wine because you had grape juice and it would ferment. And that was one way to keep something for a long time. And so they would drink wine regularly. but they would remind them not to drink too much. Not to be pushy, but be gentle. I don't know about you, but gentle and nice, that's almost become a negative characteristic in life today. If someone's nice or they're gentle, it's viewed as they're weak, when in reality, that's not true at all. And so here he's challenging us to be gentle. We're not to be thin-skinned. That's interesting, not to be worried about what other people say about us. Not to be money-hungry. My version says, free from the love of money. The love of money is a sin. Not having money, but it's the pursuit and the worship of money that becomes sin. And so don't be money hungry. He must handle his own affairs well. I've heard that is the first ministry. The ministry to your family is important. And that's where ministry starts. To be attentive to his own children and having their respect. For if someone's unable to handle his own affairs, how can he take care of God's church? Isn't it interesting? There's a lot of parallels between family and church. And then it says, he must not be a new believer, lest the position go to his head and the devil trip him up. To be a leader, you should be a Christian for a while. Outsiders must think well of him, or else the devil will figure out a way to lure him into his trap. And then it goes on to say the same for those who want to be servants. This is deacons. The term doulos is servant. And so if you want to be a servant in the church, you're to be serious but not deceitful. You're not to be too free with the bottle. That was an interesting version that Eugene Peterson says, not too free with the bottle. Not in it for what they can get out of it. I do know that in older times, people would join churches because it would put them in a better place in society, or it would help them make business connections. And it's saying, don't join a church because of that. They must be reverent before the mystery of the faith, not using their position to try to run things. Let them prove themselves first. And so in this church, we want to see you working in the church. We encourage you to serve any way that you can. And the same for women, the same qualifications happen. Serious, dependable, not sharp-tongued, not overfond with wine. Servants in the church are to be committed to their spouses, attentive to the children. He's kind of going over that again. Diligent in looking after their own affairs. Those who do this servant work will come to be highly respectable, a real credit to this Jesus faith. Now he goes on to tell why all of this matters. It's important to have this standard. As a Christian, what should we shoot for in our faith? What can we live up to? What can we strive for? And then he says, why? I hope to visit you soon, but just in case I'm delayed, I'm writing this letter so you'll know how things ought to go in God's household. This God-alive church, bastion of truth, this Christian life is a great mystery, far exceeding our understanding, but some things are clear enough. So he's saying, you may not understand everything, but you live by these standards, and you're going to be presenting forth the Christian life the best that you possibly can. In a lot of ways, our life becomes like a billboard to our faith. It can either be a great billboard and advertise people to come, or it can be a billboard to send people away. And he's saying that this Christian life is a great mystery, and it far exceeds our understanding. But here's what's clear. Jesus appeared in a human body. He was proved right by the Holy Spirit. He was seen by angels. He was proclaimed among all of the peoples, believed in all over the world, and then he was taken up to heaven. He's reminding them that this is the ministry that we have. By following these standards, we're going to be pointing people to Jesus Christ. It's pretty powerful, and he is telling us to do this. Well, my version of the Bible used a word that I didn't know, and someone found the definition for me. My Bible used the word pugnacious, that you weren't to be eager or quick to argue or quarrel or fight. So your challenge today is use the word pugnacious in a sentence. Pugnacious. Interesting. And so today, we're to strive to develop these habits, these character traits that should become such a part of who we are that we don't even have to think about it. You know, I think about basic training in the military. The whole purpose of basic training is to develop this regiment, this standard, to where it just becomes such part of who these soldiers are that they don't have to think about what to do in any situation because they've already practiced it and done it. It just becomes a habit. And I think about in our life, the habits that we can just continue to do will be so part of our faith and so part of us. The first thing, above reproach, that is integrity, to have integrity. Who are you when nobody's watching? We are to have integrity. We're to strive. And I know integrity is this broad term that actually has all of these moral laws underneath of it, but we're to be above reproach. We're to be a person of integrity. The second thing is we're to be faithful. We're to be faithful husbands and wives, faithful moms and dads, sons and daughters, and we're to be faithful Christians as well. The third one is being self-controlled. I would argue that if you were to sum up all of these, you could use self-control. Self-control, in a lot of ways, is so anti-American. We're taught to go out and enjoy life to the fullest. Yet the Bible tells us that, hey, set some boundaries. Be self-controlled. Self-controlled in everything that you do. And a lot of things will fall into place. The other thing is to be respectable. That means you've earned someone's respect. That you have you've lived with integrity, you've been faithful, you're self-controlled, and people will respect you. And then we know that greed is not a part of the Christian life. Instead, we need to be known for generosity. I can't say that enough. When people think of Christians, do they think of generous? We're to be hospitable. It's easy to be hospitable to those that we love and those that are easy to love. It's more difficult to love the unlovely. And so we're to be hospitable to everyone. And we're to be gentle. At the first service, I described Jesus as a felt-covered brick. Maybe you've heard me say that before. Jesus would bring love, but it came with a bit of a punch. He wouldn't leave the people where they're at. He would call them to action and call them to change and call them to repent. But he would do it with love. And then the last two things is to have a good reputation inside and outside the church. Strive to have a good reputation in everything you do. You can't control that entirely, right? But if you're acting with integrity and self-control and faithfulness and you're generous, you're hospitable, and you're gentle, those things will follow. And so that is the standards that Paul had set out to Timothy, challenging him. Hey, as leaders of the church, this is what you should be. As servants, this is what you should be. And so simply, how now shall I live? On that list of standards, where would you fall short? What do you know that you need to work on? Where you can grow in your faith? We all have things we need to work on. And it may be small steps you have to take. But go to God and ask Him where you can grow. And He'll be faithful. He'll show you the way. And He'll give you the strength and the wisdom to deal with it. I want to invite the band to come up. I don't know where you're at today. I don't know if you brought a burden in with you, a pain. Let me pray with you. You can come. We're going to sing our hymn of invitation. And either let the congregation pray for you or I can pray for you in private. Maybe you've never put your complete trust in Jesus Christ. Maybe you want to give your life to Him today and say, today's the day I choose to follow Jesus. Do it. Do it today. Come, let me pray with you. Let's stand and sing. So if you know Marge, you know at least part of her story. You want to go ahead and share?
Anyway, last year I couldn't come here because of COVID. I ran a compromised immune system, and it hurt. Well, Tuesday I'm going to have 33 years, and I was going to wait until I had it. But God put it on my heart because He played Amazing Grace, which I always ask for. So it was His message to tell you, God fixes anything. This year I've had too many strokes, a major stroke. I should, by all doctors' rights, be dead. But I had a wonderful family that took me to TPA, got TPA. PA in me, and I'm here today. And I'm going to tell you, and I mean it with all my heart, pray, go to church every day. I mean, if you are leaning on somebody, I'm working on somebody, Linda Poole drives me crazy because I miss her physically, but God has put her on my heart to pray for her. You know, it's too easy, I found out last year, to sit in front of the video TV and watch mm-hmm. it and not get out here. But until you walk back through those doors and you see the people that you love and you admire and respect you and help to get through, pardon the language, hell, mm-hmm. that's where you need to be, not in front of a TV set. So thank each and every one of you, whether I know you or I don't know you or I haven't met you, you're part of my story. And we'll go on from here and hopefully another year of sobriety. Thank you.
So 33 years of sobriety. We celebrate with you, Marge. And she was, I didn't really learn this until I'd met Marge, is that one issue with people struggling with sobriety is when they go into the hospital and they're faced with the narcotics that they give you, that can trip and trigger. And so she was worried about that, but you made it. Well, let's pray. Heavenly Father, Lord, we know that you care. Marge's life is proof of that. And Lord, we're reminded in song as well that the young shared that God does care for each one of us. And so, Lord, I pray that when we walk out of these doors that we're renewed, we're refreshed, and we're ready for the world today. Lord, I pray that you give us the strength to face the world, and I pray that we may strive to live to the standard you've set before us. And I just pray that in the end we'll be looking at you face to face someday in heaven. In Jesus' name, amen. Don has some announcements.
Yeah, first of all, there is a congregational meeting immediately following this service. Next Saturday at 8 a.m., a deacon's meeting. And the 22nd is a meet the teachers for the preschool. And then preschool starts the next day on the 23rd. So is there anything else I need to announce?
There's notes about family camp in
oh,
there.
Yes, family camp's Labor Day weekend. Hopefully, if everybody's going to come, they've signed up for that. If not, you need to talk to Michelle.
Yep.
So
okay.
That's all I guess. I forgot about that. Sorry.
All right. Well, it was good to worship with you again. Good to see you all. Stay safe and stay healthy. Let's sing our closing.
Above all we know, He has done great things.
defeated the